this is not a like a huge defense of what a great coach Fred Hoiberg is. But the idea is they're bad in large part because of injuries. Chris Dunn has been hurt.
Right.
Bobby Portis has missed time. Lauri Markkanen just came back and played his first game of the year. Those are big parts of what made them successful, quote unquote, last year, something that we looked forward to this year, and they haven't been there. And so to fire him this quick, knowing that you had the health issues that they had, it seems a little kind of reactionary. My thing is always when you fire a coach this quick in a season, that means you came into the season having doubts.
Right.
So if you had doubts before the season started, why'd you wait?
Yeah, so the timing's weird to me. One, because as you mentioned, the timing, when you think about the relationship that we supposedly knew about between Fred Hoiberg and Gar, like that existed back to the Iowa State days.
Right.
So all of a sudden something changed over a year, multi-year long relationship, 24 games into the season, they have a change of course. I think it's interesting that they are coming out and saying it seems like Jim Boylen will be the coach next year. So perhaps that is actually the reasoning here is that they just had more faith in one of the assistant coaches on his staff.
We'll get to Boylen in a second, but here's the way I look at it. I almost feel like he was set up to fail from the beginning. He was a college coach. I know he had experience running an organization or being part of a front office in Minnesota, but as a head coach, he came into a situation with the Bulls, a team that was kind of older, a veteran team. He got off on the wrong foot with Noah, if you recall that, where Noah basically was going to the bench. Hoiberg said he was supposed to, that he had wanted to do it. Clearly that wasn't the case. So there were already issues with him and the veterans. This team that he's coaching now is what he's probably better suited to coach. So I feel like the timing certainly kind of caught up with him there, where they probably should have thought of this down the road. They should have gone veteran guy with the veteran squad and then bring in a Hoiberg type with these guys.
And okay, so look at this list. This is a crack research staff at The Jump put together. Look at all these coaches that have come in since Phil Jackson. And this is just, I know it's been 20 years since Phil Jackson coached the Bulls, but what it says to me is when you have a championship window like they had at the end of this the six-peat Bulls with Phil Jackson there, you don't prematurely close it of your own doing.
Right.
And so it reminds me what the Cavs went through the last several years. When you have one of the greatest players of all time in their prime, make sure you're putting everything to the middle of the table to give yourself the best chance to win. The Cavs will probably have their third head coach since LeBron left between Ty Lue, Larry Drew, and whoever they signed this summer. And the Bulls list only continues. They have their second Jim Boylen coaching the team.
It's crazy.
Since Phil Jackson.
Yeah, I was about to say,
that's second tour.
The same Jim Boylen, yes. America. It's a completely different Jim Boylen, I promise you. But no, the thing I was going to say when you look through those names, Dave, is what makes me think of at the end of every one of those tenures, that management group has found a way to blame. It's Vinny's fault.
It's
right?
always on
right.
the coach.
Right. Yeah. Paxson and Vinny got into a fight. And then Thibodeau got the worst firing press release I've ever seen in my life. You know, and now Hoiberg getting fired a month into the season. And even when you go back earlier, Skiles and Cartwright and those guys, it's always somebody else's fault. And at some point, if you, quote-unquote, keep picking the wrong coach, let's just assume it was all their fault. When is it your fault for picking the wrong coach every single
time? What's the one consistent thing?
It's those guys.
Packs.
Yeah, for sure. And speaking of which, in a press conference today, John Paxson said the team plans to stick with Jim Boylen as head coach next season, as you mentioned, Dave. Boylen takes over as permanent head coach with no interim title and is currently signed through the 2019-20 season. So, Dave, where do Boylen and the Bulls go from here? Do you try to get a longer extension?
I mean, that's what he should be coaching for this year. Listen, is it a great NBA job? Probably not because of what we said, the reason that the front office is a little volatile. But it's still an NBA head coaching job. There's only 30 of them.
Right.
Jim Boylen was an assistant in San Antonio, was a head coach in college. Yep. This is his chance to try to have a young, talented group and grow with them. So absolutely he should be trying to coach to get that extension.
Well, but on the front end, should he try to do it? Kind of like Drew did?
Oh, and stand out? I mean, it doesn't seem like that's the case. With Drew, they held off on giving that interim title or that head coach title.
Yeah.
So it doesn't seem like he's played that card.
Right, and I don't think he has to because it seems like when they say they're guaranteeing next year, they're going to give him a bump. I think I read in The Athletic he's making less than $1 million right now. So they're going to get him a pay raise. But the interesting thing here is what I said to the producers on the phone was the Chicago job reminds me of a mixture of the Lakers job last year and the Suns job in the sense that on the one hand there's young talent, there's cap flexibility, it's a nice city, like they should be able to get good really quickly. So it's kind of like the Lakers job. Like maybe we can get like a superstar to come here and say, I like what you guys are building. I want to be a part of that. Kind of like what LeBron came to Lakers. Mm-hmm. But the other side of that coin is the Suns job, which nice young talent, great city, some cap flexibility. But I have absolutely no faith in the management and the leadership of that organization.
Right.
And in that sense, maybe it's not a great job. But it, like Dave said, man, if you're a guy who has never been a head coach in this league, it's really hard to say no, even when the opportunity isn't really good.
Yeah, I think that's the type of guy they have to find another Fred Hoiberg, basically, right? Sure. Because either an assistant or a college coach or something like that. Because a guy that's worth his salt, as far as a coach is concerned, any of those guys that may be out there or interested, aren't taking that job with those guys.
But, I mean, here's a question, and this is what I was wondering. When you fire Fred Hoiberg for 75-19, is the expectation that, hey, we should be contending for the playoffs, or do they now do the development thing? Because I think that really matters too, as far as what kind of personnel decisions they can make from here on out.
And this is so much reminds me of the Cleveland situation, because how can you really say they have had a chance to compete with Lauri Markkanen not in there? Same thing with Kevin Love not in there for Cleveland.
Chris Dunn, yeah.
Right. So you have to kind of have a moving target when those things happen. Perhaps this is a sign that the management is completely moving target and embracing the tank.
And if we are going to embrace the tank, then we just saw a little clip there of Justin Holiday, of Robin Lopez doing things. These are vets on excellent contracts that can help other teams. You can get some value for this, but you have to make the decision today that we're going to be trash this year.
Okay, as a guy who's been a local radio host before for a number of times, this is a savvy media move, though. The Bears are coming off a loss. Their rival fires their head coach. They're doing this to kind of slip this under the radar locally. I bet you that's part of the plan here.
So Mike McCarthy, it's your fault.
Yeah, well, and the Bears losing. And they're like, oh, they're going to be worried about all that stuff. They're not going to worry about us.